I was in the back enjoying the music and the fellowship and forgot that this was my part. So, this is my part. Good morning. I'm glad you could be with us here at Christian Fellowship. Those of you watching online and on television, we'd like to welcome you as well. We've got a special morning this morning. We've got some folks who are going to share with us the principles of freedom in Christ. And so we're going to deviate from our series that we've been doing on 1 John. Cindy Lou Eberhardt is going to share with us, and Terry Pausch is going to share with us. So we're really excited about that. And I want to tell you that part of that freedom in Christ comes during this portion of the service. It comes during this portion where we praise and worship the Lord, and we just kind of, I often refer to it as just laying it at the cross. You've got stuff going on in your life. You've got, oh man, we have heartache and we have misery and we have all kinds of stuff going on in our life. It's a great opportunity right now to just take and lay that at the foot of the cross during this time of praise and worship and singing. So I just want to encourage you to do that as we start out with the music this morning. Take this opportunity to just say, you know what, God, it's really not about me. It's all about you. And that's what we're going to focus on. You can be free this morning. Let's open with a word of prayer. Father, I thank you that you are able, your word says, you are able to do exceeding abundantly above all we could ask or think. And today, Father, I know that each one of us comes with a certain amount of baggage. We come with a certain amount of hurt. And sometimes we have really good days and weeks and months, and we're able to go on and things are good and we really feel free. And then there are mornings when we just kind of feel like we've had a tough morning. This morning, God, we just turn that over to you. We choose to focus on you today and the fact that you've come to set us free. So, Lord, we just pray over this next period of time. We dedicate this hour and a half to you, God, and we just pray that you will just receive our praise and that we can just clear our hearts and enjoy your presence. We just ask this now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
We just invite you to stand with us this morning as we sing praises to God. We just want to start with, as we pray, just give it to God. We know that great and wonderful things can happen in that spiritual realm, even the physical realm, as we pray. As we really, truly lay it at the foot of the cross and give it to God. As we just talk to him about everything we need to talk to him about. So whatever that is today, I encourage you to do that. As we pray.
to one God, for one cause, that all may know you. One voice to one God, for one cause, that all may know you. One voice to one God, for one cause, that all may know your love. Let heaven's gates be open, let words of life be spoken, not ours but your will be done, Father. As we pray, bring freedom and forgiveness, bring healing and repentance, for only you can save us, Father. As we pray, the heavens gates be open, let words of life be spoken, not ours but your will be done, Father. As we pray to you, bring healing and forgiveness, bring healing and repentance, for only you can save us, Father. As we pray to you, as we pray to you, as we pray to you,
as we pray to you, as we pray to you, freedom and bring healing. We just bless your name.
Blessed be the name. So
rise up now more than we ever have before. God, we ask as the battle rages that this army would rise up, Lord God, and take our places. Chains do not need to be binding our camp, Lord Jesus. I speak to marriages this morning. I believe that God wants to take marriages and bring them to where they were designed. Lord God, we speak to marriages right now, Lord Jesus. Break the chains of broken marriages, Lord God. Break the chains of these husband and wives that don't know where they take their place, Lord God. Men, rise up, be leaders, head your families. Wives, let your vision and your passion rise up. Please, Lord God, have mercy on us, Lord Jesus. Your amazing grace covers us all, Lord God. We love your grace. We love your mercy. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
How precious in that grace. hearts, Lord. And Father, we do cry out to you at this time, Lord. Father, draw us unto you, that we might walk in the way that you would have us to walk, that we might be the people that you would have us to be. We just thank you for that word, Lord. Thank you. God, help us.
Turn and just say good morning to somebody, and then you can have a seat.
If you enjoyed this program, we'd love to hear from you. Comments can be sent to us online or write to us at the address on your screen.
Well, good morning. We're going to have our ushers come forward. We're going to receive our morning offering this morning. Offering is simply a time for us to be able to give back to the Lord a portion of what He's given us. It's our opportunity to sow into the kingdom. It's our opportunity to walk in obedience to where God would take us. So this is an opportunity for us to practice obedience and sow into the kingdom. Father, we just thank you for your goodness towards us. We thank you, God, that you've provided us with life and liberty. You've provided us with freedom. God, you've provided us with our jobs and income. Your word declares that you are the one who gives us the ability to gain wealth. So, Father, this morning we pour back into, Father, the work of the kingdom here in this community. God, I ask you to bless each person who's here and just pour back into their lives, I pray, this morning as they give. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We just have a few announcements. There was bulletins available on the wall out there as you came in. Again, we have Children's Church is going on, One-Way Kids. If you have kids ages 5 to 5th grade, it's a great opportunity for them to get down there and plug in with kids their own age, and there's some fun stuff going on. Also, this morning, Terry Pausch again and Cindy Lou Eberhardt will be our speakers. They'll be talking about Freedom in Christ Ministry, and I will introduce Terry here in just a minute. Take a look at the bulletin. Next Sunday, we will be having our pot blessing. For those of you whose names are on the list, you find out where you're at, and that's the dish that you bring along with you. So please come prepared for a pot blessing. Also, beginning on Tuesday, October 8th, there will be a Victory Over the Darkness class. We'll be starting here at 7 o'clock, and Cindy Lou Eberhardt's going to lead that. I just want to encourage you today as she talks about victory over darkness, as they talk about freedom in Christ. That's where this is kind of headed. So I just want to encourage you to participate in that as God would put it on your heart. Also, this past Wednesday night, we had a gym night at the middle school. And from what I understand, I wasn't able to go. There were 35 people there. It sounded like it was a pretty good time. So throughout the winter, we have rented a gym for the church. Once a month at the DL Middle School. You can see that the next one is October 23rd from 6:30 to 8:30. Volleyball, basketball, I'm going to say dodgeball and hope that nothing comes flying at me this morning like last week. Board games, just come and be a part. I mean, it's a great time. We've talked about, just a little deviation from the announcements, we've talked about this being a family. And we've talked about going from values to vision. Where does it become important? Where do we really say we're going to draw a line in the sand Because one of the values can be, oh, we're going to have a family reunion once every 10 years. But come that 10th year, somebody better show up or it's not really a value, right? Three people. At least once every 10 years, you ought to get together. Well, that's what we're talking about with this family fun night. If it's a family fun night, if we're saying we are a family of believers in Jesus, then once a month we ought to get together and just have some fun. Amen? Amen. All right, we're up to 7. We'll keep working on that. So come and be a part of that. Also, just take a look. There's a benefit for Terry and Martha Rushford. Many of you know Martha had a lung removed, and she had some difficulty there with that. She's well on her way to recovery. So Sunday, October 13th, 5 o'clock at the Refuge, there's going to be a chili cook-off. Please avail yourself of that. Be a part of that. Contestants, bring your best chili to the Refuge between 3 and 4 that day, and then there's going to be a silent auction as well. So with that said, please participate. That's a great opportunity for us to show her support. Now, Cindy Lou Eberhardt came to me several months ago, probably, I don't know, maybe even a year ago, and we were talking about freedom in Christ. And she asked my opinion, if you will, on the Freedom in Christ ministry. It's something that I've observed. It's something we had as part of the church I was in the last church I was involved in. So we've seen some really good, really amazing things take place. And Cindy Lou has gone on to get some training through Freedom in Christ. And she has become friends with Terry Pausch. Terry and her husband Dennis have lived here in the area since 1974. Dennis was actually born and raised here in the area. They have 3 children, 12 grandchildren. They are members of Community Alliance Church here in DL. Terry and Dennis are. And Terry has been sharing the basics of Freedom in Christ since 1996, and she is a ministry associate with Freedom in Christ since 2004. Folks, we all have stuff that gets in our life that holds us in bondage. And Freedom in Christ is about being set free. It's about getting rid of those things that kind of hold us back. Not kind of, that hold us back. And so this morning, we're going to take this next, the rest of the remainder of our service, and Terry is going to share some of the truths that she has discovered. She's going to share some of the truths of freedom in Christ, and then Cindy Lou is also going to share with us. So I'm going to ask you just to give Terry a warm welcome as she comes and shares with us.
Good morning. Thank you, Pastor Tim. And thank you for the beautiful music. It really brought us to really a place of worship this morning. Some really good freedom songs there that I'm going to have to get a hold of that was fairly new to me. So thank you for that. And thank you. It's just an honor to be able to come here and talk to you about something that is so near and dear to my heart. Really my favorite thing to talk about, and that's freedom in Christ. Freedom in Christ as the inheritance of every believer, and as a reality for us as children of God, and also as Freedom in Christ as a ministry. Why am I so passionate about this ministry? Well, it was really coming to an understanding of the scriptural truths of Freedom in Christ, the scriptural truths that are foundational to this ministry, truths that pointed me to Jesus as the bondage breaker, and truths that helped me understand what he saw when he looks at me. Those truths changed my life. And that began about 18 years ago now. And I'd just like to take a minute to talk about something that happened about 15 years before that. Now, I know I'm getting close to telling you how old I am, but not really. 15 years before I came to an understanding of what freedom in Christ truths were to mean in my life, I received the most wonderful gift that I will ever receive in my life. I received Jesus as my Savior. And I was very excited about that when I received that gift, and I came to understand that he died for me and that I now had forgiveness of sins and I had eternal life as a gift from him. And I was very excited about that. But as is so often the case, I didn't look back in the box. I didn't check to see if there was more. Down, you know, in the tissue paper to see if there might be more here. And you know what? There really is so much more than I knew. Sadly, 15 years it took me to look back in the box to see what lay there unnoticed for so long. According to 2 Peter 3:1-3, everything I need for life and godliness, everything I needed for life on planet Earth where the hard stuff takes place, was right there. It was mine all the time. I didn't even know it. Freedom in Christ Ministries is a discipleship ministry, and it's all about what came in the package. If you can imagine, it's pretty exciting to point people to what's in the box that they didn't even know was there. In order to give you an idea of how Freedom in Christ came to be or why it's necessary as a ministry, I'm going to let Neil Anderson, founder of Freedom in Christ Ministries, and Rich Miller, the current president, and a couple other folks tell you a little bit about it.
As a pastor, I had people in my church who had problems that I didn't have answers for, which really bothered me. I believe Christ was the answer. I believe truth has set people free. I just didn't see it. I would pray with people. I would read the Bible. I'd pray as faithfully as I could and counsel as best I knew how. But the problem seemed to continue.
I think a lot of people are bombarded, even barraged, by thoughts like, oh, you're stupid. You can't do anything right. You're really evil. You're worthless. You'll never amount to anything. God doesn't really love you. God's too busy, doesn't care about you.
When I read my Bible, I saw a lot more victory than when I was seeing evidenced by the people in my churches. And so I would say from the get-go for me, it was to say, there's got to be an answer. And I know it's Christ, but how?
Most people are believing lies about God, about themselves, about how to live life, believing that, like I said earlier, the Christian life maybe works for others, but not for them.
Every hurting Christian we've dealt with, it was like they were ignorant of their spiritual heritage. If the Holy Spirit is bearing witness with our spirit, we're children of God, why weren't they sensing that? And yet none of these people knew who they were in Christ.
When I look at the church in the United States, I see a lot of strong emphasis on bringing people to salvation, presenting the gospel, wanting people to have eternal life and to go to heaven when they die. But I think there's a bridge, a gap between salvation and maturity that we've missed, and that is the whole area of freedom.
From the outside looking in, it seemed like I had my life together, but from the inside looking out, I knew that it wasn't what it should have been. There was an emptiness, there was a yearning, there was a longing for more.
Independence kept me very, very away from the Lord, not depending on Him, depending on myself. I can do this. I can handle all of this.
I began a pattern that evolved into an addiction to pornography and sexual lust, fantasy lust. And that is such a sad, sad thing for me to think about and how it marked my loved ones.
I started thinking, okay, I'm just tired. I'm tired of all this. I don't know what I'm doing anymore. I don't know who God is anymore. Did I ever know who God was?
I had no understanding of God as my Father at that point in time in terms of a caring, compassionate, gentle Father.
I think a lot of people, as Thoreau said, live lives of quiet desperation spiritually, not knowing quite how to get out of the mess that they're in.
The next piece of the video is going to start with a passage from Hebrews 12. It says, "Let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus." We as believers and followers of Jesus are supposed to be able to do that. Just throw off that stuff that hinders. Walk away from that sin that so easily entangles. And some of you might be sitting there thinking about someone you know that struggles. And you might be thinking, yeah, why don't they just do that? Why don't they just walk away from that? Why don't they just stop? Can't they see that it's hurting them? Can't they see what it's doing to their testimony? And you've told them? It doesn't seem to have helped. What do you really have to offer them? And some of you might be sitting there hearing this passage that you're supposed to be able to do this thing, and you're thinking, what's wrong with me that I can't do that? Am I so different that it doesn't work for me? To you, I want to say, there is an answer. I want to say you don't have to stay stuck. And it's not the way God made you, as you might have told yourself. There's freedom available to you. And it's not about just trying harder to get your act together. There truly is freedom. I'd like to say I can just give that to you today. But what I want for you is to come to an understanding and be able to believe the truths that I was talking about, those foundational truths to freedom in Christ that changed my life. Because the change, that big transformation word, is available to you. It really is. I hope that this piques your interest, and that way more than that, that it will give you hope, and that you will look into more and more about what freedom in Christ has to offer you. Freedom in Christ has three parts, and we call them the three T's: teaching, taking, and training. And the three T's are to get us to the fourth T, and that's transformation. The first T, the teaching, it's about Bible study. It's about learning those scriptural truths that changed my life. It's about classes that are made available to you with so much good practical information. Maybe you'd be interested in learning about how your mind influences your emotions. Or maybe you'd like to know more about why it is that sometimes your emotions seem to dictate the way you act. And you know that verse, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ? Many Christians would really like to know how that's all supposed to really work, because they're still trying to get rid of that condemnation. And you'll also have a chance to learn what God sees when he looks at you, what he really sees. If there's any part of that thought of God looking at you that causes you to want to cringe a little bit or slide down your seat a little, I hope that you will look into these truths of what God sees when he looks at you. You may have even heard some of the things that he says, but somehow you haven't been able to really come to believe it yet. It can make all the difference. It really can. To learn what God sees when he looks at you, you'll be so glad if you look into that. The second T is taking. Taking people through the steps to freedom. This is about setting aside a time for an encounter with God. The thing that I have come to appreciate so much about the ministry of freedom in Christ is that the responsibility for seeking freedom, the responsibility for looking for the answers, is placed squarely on the one who wants to be free. The others in the ministry are just there to walk alongside, to objectively encourage them and bring them to the right place before the throne of God. That's what it's about. And I love that about this ministry. To walk people through this process called the steps to freedom. And then you, as the freedom seeker, are the one who intentionally takes these steps before the Lord. While we are being prayed for, you choose According to what God reveals to you as obstacles in your life, you choose to remove each one so that your relationship with the Lord can grow deeper and deeper. Here's a little bit more about that.
There's a couple things that amaze us when we take people through the steps to freedom. One is people will look at us and say, I've never told anybody this before. And why are they telling us? Because somehow they sense the presence of the gracious Christ and the accepting Christ who's there, and it's a safe place. And for most people, the one thing that they need to share for freedom is the thing that they're most scared to share. There's most shame attached to it.
I find that people may not share with me, or they may even lie to me, but they will not lie to God. It's the most amazing thing. When they ask God, who do I need to forgive? Out comes those 20 names, or, I've had sex with that person, out that comes. They don't lie to God.
When real repentance takes place and people begin to see, my goodness, I believe so many lies about my life and my family and God, and they choose to embrace the truth, then their behavior can change.
It's replacing the lies with the truth and giving them, recognizing the lies. First of all, you have to recognize the lies, and then replacing each lie of it with the truth of who God says I am.
It was just like my eyes just grew open. I'm a child of God. I'm in Christ already. I've been transferred out of darkness into light. I'm not in the flesh anymore.
God sees me as pure as a new fallen snow, not because all of a sudden a bad man has been made good, but because a dead man has been given life.
It was like God just flooded my heart. I mean, just flooded my heart with Him, with His whole being and His whole presence. It was a newness, a freshness, a love that I had never ever felt before.
Because of the experiences I had growing up with all the abuse, I felt like a broken person. And one of the verses that speaks to me is, I am complete in Christ. I'm not broken. I'm not shattered. I am complete.
To be able to have a sense of, I am safe and secure spiritually in Christ. I know God loves me, accepts me. I don't have to perform somehow and jump through these spiritual hoops to gain His favor, that God just simply plain loves me.
Who I am is, I am Christ's friend. I am Christ's friend.
The racing thoughts are gone, the shouting's gone, the noise is gone. It's quiet in their minds for the first time when they maybe didn't even realize it was possible to have that kind of peace. And so we just sit there, having seen people come in with suicidal tendencies or such abuse issues, that how in the world could the Lord ever set them free, and watch them with our mouths open as they leave that session with no more anger, no more bitterness, no more unforgiveness, free, experiencing life and joy and peace like they never have before. It really works.
As you can imagine, this part of the ministry is a pretty fulfilling part to take place and to get to watch. I often just sit back and say, wow, God, why do I get to sit here and watch You work in someone's life? What a privilege to get to do that. It's truly amazing. And the third T is training. And that's all about helping others have that same privilege of bringing others to the throne of grace, bringing people to this beautiful encounter with God, training others to have that wonderful experience of watching God set people free. He is making people ready. They have to be ready. It's not for everybody at every moment, but God is working in people's lives to bring them to that place where they're ready. There's a story told about a dog who is laying on the porch, and he's just laying there moaning and groaning. And there's two gentlemen in their rocking chairs looking down at the dog moaning and groaning. One gentleman says to the other, "What's wrong with the dog?" And the other one says, "He's laying on a nail." And the other one says, "Why don't he move?" The answer, "It don't hurt enough yet." For some, it doesn't hurt enough yet. But for some, it does, and they're ready. And we want to be ready. We want to be ready to take advantage of this incredible privilege that we have of walking people through this process. And it is an incredible experience, and maybe some of you will want to join us in that process. There's a passage in Luke 4 that I want to share with you, starting with verse 16. It says, "So he, Jesus, came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read. And he was handed the book of the prophet Isaiah. And when he had opened the book, he found the place where it was written, 'The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord.' Then he closed the book, and he gave it back to the attendant, and he sat down." And the next line says, "And the eyes of all who were in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say this to them, 'Today, this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing.'" What a moment. He told them who he was. He told them he was the Christ that had come to bring them the good news, to bring healing, and yes, to bring freedom. And because this same Holy Spirit, this same Spirit of the Lord, is on us, because we have this incredible privilege that Jesus has taken up residence within us, we get to continue his work. We get the privilege of doing this with others. That just really blows my mind. That the God of the universe, the creator of all things, wants to use me. I know he doesn't need me. He doesn't need you, Cindy Lou. He doesn't need any of you. And yet, he's going to let us be used by him. We get to take part in all those things mentioned in that passage, sharing the good news with the spiritually needy and poor. We get to bring the healing touch of Jesus. We get to bring that to the brokenhearted and to bring the good news, the message of liberty to those who've been held captive, that are sitting paralyzed, so that they can be free. And the last line, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. I don't know if you're familiar with the concept from the Old Testament concept, where the captives were set free, where the slaves were delivered, and where everyone was given an opportunity for a fresh start. That's what Jesus is offering. That's what he's offering to you. It's what he was offering then. It's what he's offering now. And we get to receive it. And we get to tell it. Just as exciting. And verse 22 says, "So all bore witness to him and marveled at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth." They were amazed at what they were hearing from Jesus. And then, wait a minute. Then they said, "Isn't this Joseph's son?" They thought they knew him. "Isn't this the Jesus that we've known?" They thought they knew who he was, but did they? Many of you might think that you know Cindy Lou Eberhardt, but do you? Cindy Lou has gone through quite a process to become a Community Freedom Ministry Associate with Freedom in Christ. She's been studying for hours, and she's been taking classes and having to pass tests, and she has been interviewed and asked some really hard questions, all so that it could be determined if she has the heart and the understanding that it's going to take to love and protect and lead people to the throne of grace with compassion and with mercy. Maybe some of you know better than I do the love that she has for the hurting. I think I know pretty well. And I know that she believes that Jesus is the answer and that she is going to point them to him. As the healer of hurts, the binder of wounds, and the bondage breaker. And I, for one, am thrilled that she has followed his call into this ministry. Now, some of you might know that there's this line that Cindy Lou uses, and I know it is never her intent to put anyone on the spot. She sincerely wants to know what the Lord's been doing in your life. And I'm going to use it on her now. Cindy Lou, what's the Lord been doing in your life?
I am so excited about being here today. Can you hear me? Can you hear me now? Okay. The first thing I have to do is every time I see my grandsons, this is what I do. Woohoo! I cannot express how excited I am to be here. I'm going to stick with my notes so I kind of stay on track. Seeing the community and Freedom in Christ ministry presented here today is truly an honor because of how it's impacted my life. The first time I took a look at this ministry was in 2005, right after I had moved to Detroit Lakes. They had a weekend seminar. I remember thinking that I would love to be involved with this. And I heard the testimonies of how people had been set free. I knew I was going to heaven, but I wanted this freedom here on earth. And since I had accepted Christ in 1989, I knew I was free from the condemnation of hell. My husband Jim had encouraged me to go to the seminar, but the funny part is, he didn't ask me to go for the message. He wanted me to meet Terry. In the 4.5 years that we had dated, prior to getting married, Jim spoke about three women that had impacted his life in such an incredible way that he wanted me to meet them. Terry was one of those women. When I got to the seminar and it was all over with, Jim comes up to me and says, "So, did you meet Terry? So, did you talk to Terry?" He didn't ask me what the message was about. Over the next 5 years, I had the opportunity to go to several Bible studies, to learn more about freedom in Christ. And the more I learned, the more God had knit my heart to this ministry and to Terry. It didn't make sense to me, though, because my life direction was not headed that way. Not only did the opportunity or the time allow for a close relationship to develop with Terry, as most of you know, on December 7th, 2010, when the ambulance was getting ready to take Jim's body to the mortuary, Terry was on the phone with her daughter, Joy, who at that very same moment in time was driving past our property. Joy asked her, "Mom, do Jim and Cindy Lou live in the same place?" Terry said, "Yes, and why?" Joy said, "It doesn't look good, Mom." They hung up and Terry called me and found out that Jim had passed away. As I had said, Terry and I were not close friends at this point, but she chose to drop everything that morning to come and be with me and to escort me for arrangements to be made. I believe with all my heart that God ordained Joy's steps that day to be driving past our property at that very moment she was on the phone to her mom. In God's word, it says that all things work for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. Today is proof of that in my life.
God knew that Jim insisting on me meeting Terry would reveal God's plan for me to be part of the Freedom in Christ ministry. Freedom in Christ to me is about recognizing the truth of who our Heavenly Father is and who He says that we are in Christ, and reinforcing it without restraint or hindrance. It is an example of how we need each other. A story picture of this is in Exodus 17, when the Israelites were in battle with Amalek. While Moses had his hands raised, as long as he had his hands raised, the battle was being won. If his hands dropped, Amalek was winning. When Moses became too weary to hold his hands up, Aaron and Hur stepped up and held his hands until the battle was won. We need each other. Since Terry was doing the sharing on ministry today, and because I'm always asking people, what is God doing in your life? I get the privilege to share today of what He's been doing in my life because of the Freedom in Christ message and what lies I have been believing. I love how our relationship with Christ is like an onion. It gets peeled away layer by layer. And as each layer is peeled away, God reveals what is in our heart, and at the same time, He reveals His heart. One of the areas of walking out in freedom in my life has been to be rather than to do. Most of my Christian walk has been about the doing rather than the resting or the waiting. When you have a helps gift, it's really hard not to make it all about the good we are doing. Don't get me wrong, I know we have to do, and God will use us. But in order to do what I'm called to do and to be where I'm called to be, I need to first know, really know, who is my God according to His word and by spending time with Him rather than just being spent on all the doing. I want to repeat that. I know we have to do, and God will use us, but in order to do what I'm called to do and to be where I'm called to be, I need to know my God according to His word and spending time with Him rather than just being spent on the doing. God has given me the freedom to lay things down and choose Him first, then let Him choose my direction. Another area of freedom God has been showing me that I'm walking out is having to be understood. From the time I was a little girl, I have a need to be understood. Even until recently, if somebody didn't seem to understand me or you didn't like what I had to say, I would want to go to you and explain to you to the nth degree, because I needed to be understood. Well, when God says that He will supply our every need, He's showing me that He understands me and it's okay. God alone can supply that need. And as I continue to look for that in others, I'm only wasting their time and mine. Probably one of the biggest areas of freedom I believe that God is allowing me to walk out is to really know to wait on God and that His option is the best. It's humbling, but a lot of time in my prayer life, I've gone to God about what I wanted. Yes, I pray God's word, but a lot of it has been about what I want or what I think is best. And we all know God has a sense of humor. I was spending time with God a couple weeks ago, and I've been actually asking Him for new material for comedy, just to be funny, because I tend to make fun of myself. So if you ever think of that, just ask God to download some stuff for me, because I love to joke around. Well, I'm in my bedroom, and I'm spending time with God, and this chorus keeps playing in my head. It didn't make sense to me, because I don't know that I've ever actually heard the song, but I kept hearing the chorus. So I was preparing for what I was going to share, and the next morning it was still there. I got to work, and it was still there. So I went to God, and I'm like, God, what is this about? It has to be something You're trying to show me. And He said, isn't this how You come to me in prayer? And I'll tell you, after you hear this clip, if this is how you go to God, it'll change your prayer life. Mike, if you would go ahead and share that.
Yo, say what I want, what I really, really want. I'll tell you what I want, what I really, really want.
Okay, now we have a God that has a sense of humor. I did not think that music clip up. See, that is funny. Thank you, God. Okay, so God had impressed upon my heart that this has been a big part of my prayer life, and that He wanted to make the decisions for my life, and that if I would just be willing to quit talking and just listen. And how personal God is, that He would give me a song I don't know that I've ever heard. Jim would always say that I wanted to pray about everything. That might have been true, but I didn't want to wait for the answers. I believe God is showing me freedom, that I'm walking out in areas, in this area, but it doesn't always mean that the waiting is easy. I had a lot of decisions to make. I had shared that God had spoken to me after Jim had passed away, a lot of decisions that had to be made, and he had spoken to me. I believe that he had said that if I would go right down the middle and not to the left or the right, that he would show himself faithful. Well, through conversations with some really close friends, I realized that to somebody else, going to the left or the right might sound like I think I'm going to the wrong direction, or that God might be disappointed in me. And that was not my thought process whatsoever. I love how God brings those things to the surface layer by layer. In my understanding, turning to the left meant my understanding. Turning to the right meant my way. And right down the middle meant what God's best was for me. It's not that I thought God would be disappointed or that He would be upset with me. So I want you to seriously consider the next time that you are struggling to wait on God, that you would stop and think and say, okay, if I go to the left, is that my understanding? If I go to the right, is that my way? But what if I go right down the middle, what God has best for me? If I use that analogy every time, I would prefer not to wait on God. It would greatly encourage me to stay right there until I get His answer. In Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways. Acknowledge Him and He will make your path straight. When the actual date was set for me to share, I started asking God to reveal to me any lies that He wanted to bring to the surface of my heart. Neil Anderson points out two significant things about that will line up to the lie that God brought to me. Number one, it isn't what you do that determines who you are. It's who you are that determines what you do. And number two, no one can consistently behave in a way that is inconsistent to how they perceive themselves. I'm going to repeat that. It is not what you do that determines who you are. It is who you are that determines what you do. And number two, no one can consistently behave in a way that is inconsistent to how they perceive themselves. I had wrestled whether or not to actually share what the lie is, and I believe I meant to, so that you'll get the whole picture of how I've allowed this lie to be my own personal mission statement, without fully understanding the impact it had on me. Okay, I want you to hold on to that thought and I'll come back to it. On Mother's Day weekend, I went to my son's house to visit, and as I was pulling into the driveway, my grandsons, they were chalking out the three-point line. And my grandson Quincy and Sam had a friend over, and they asked me to play two-on-two with them. My heart said, wow, they want me to play? My head said, are you kidding me? Don't they see that I'm overweight and out of shape? My grandsons see me as Grandma Cindy. They don't see me the way I see me. That day I heard four words that made me feel like $1 million. We started to play basketball, and I started to make shots. And Quincy and Sam's friend said, "Wow, Grandma got game." I left that weekend convinced that this time I was going to get it right. I'm going to go home, I'm going to get in shape, I'm going to lose weight. This time I have a real reason to do it. I wonder how many times I've said that and how many times I've been around that mountain. I did great, and then before I knew it, I was saying what Paul says in Romans 7:15. "For I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do I do not do, but what I hate I do." Going back to what Neil points out, no one can consistently behave in a way that is inconsistent to how they perceive themselves. When I was 16 years old, somebody that I believed loved me told me how fat and ugly I was. A few years later, I was told the exact same thing by somebody else I thought loved me. In my understanding, if two total strangers to each other told me this, it had to be true. I took that lie on as truth and have allowed it to become my mission statement. Anybody that knows me or is in close proximity of me, my whole life I've made fun of myself. That's why I'm asking God to download new material. I love to joke, but it wasn't a joke. It's just that it's easier to point it out to you because it hurts less, or at least I think it hurts less, if I say it before you do. I didn't know how to reject the lie, so I walked right into bondage. I really want you to grasp that this is about believing a lie. It's not about weight, because at that point, I was 90 pounds lighter than I am today. But I was still in bondage. I have spent a lifetime of pointing out my faults and making fun of them. Over the years, I have tried every possible diet and have been successful as long as I followed it to the T, and yet always ending up in the back in the same place. I don't believe God is concerned about my outward appearance, since the Bible says he looks at my heart. Does that mean that I don't think I should be healthy or do all I can to be healthy? Of course I believe I should. But why would I be able to be effective if the belief system I have goes against the freedom in this area, and if what I'm believing does not line up to what the Word of God says about me? I'll repeat that. Why would I be able to be effective in my belief system if what I believed went against the freedom in this area, and if what I'm believing does not line up to what the Word of God says about me? I have struggled with this so many years, and I've always ended up trying the legalist point of view. I'll try harder next time. I had already been around that mountain several times. I'm positive that there are people in my path that have thought, "Why don't you just get it? Just do it." But not once in all the years that I've cried out to God and said I wanted help has he ever just impressed upon me, "Why don't you just do it?" But each time he said, "Come to me and I'll show you how to do it." And just as an example of his grace is putting me in an apartment that has 25 stairs that I go up 4 or 5 times a day. And my parking spot got moved, so now I have to walk 2 blocks to my car, which God has a sense of humor, and he's also looking out for me. You see, God wanted to go deeper with me. He wanted to go past my thinking right to my heart. He wanted my belief in this area to line up to his word and not my own thinking. From the moment that God has shown me this lie, as only he can, I have chosen to take him at his word. Each morning when I get up, I look in the mirror and I say, "I renounce the lie that I am fat and ugly, and I confess the truth that I am fearfully and wonderfully made. and that the Spirit of the living God is in me. Will that magically change my appearance? Absolutely not. But it does take my eyes off of what I look like, what other people might think of me, and it lets me go through the day going about my Father's business. Not one day since I have been confessing this truth have I thought about those same thoughts, what I look like, what somebody else is going to think. And even, maybe somebody can't relate to this, but it was so bad that even though I live on Washington Avenue, this is just being real, I didn't want to walk down Washington Avenue because the thoughts that I had were that you were so fat and ugly, Cindy, that's what they're going to notice. But I am set free of that. That's my choice to walk that out. Freedom empowers me to do it His way and give up trying mine. It empowers me to consistently make better choices rather than letting a lie dominate my life. It is like with the law. It's not that I have to follow the law. It's by grace that I get to follow the law according to God's best for me. In January of this year, God gave me Psalms 119:46. I will walk in freedom, for I have sought out your precepts. According to the dictionary, a precept is a commandment or direction given as a rule of action. It didn't make sense back in January, but it sure does now. God's way gives me freedom and the choice to walk in that freedom. Galatians 5:1. For it is freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by the yoke of slavery. I have that choice to walk this freedom out. My heart in sharing this is to encourage you to ask God if you are believing any lies about you or your life that does not line up to the Word of God. Maybe it's a fear in your life rather than a lie. I want to challenge you to ask God, because in John 8:32, then you will know the truth and the truth will set you free. As the song, The Truth About Me, is playing, I want you to allow God to show you how He really sees you. I also want to ask for the volunteers to come forward, that I have 11 volunteers, and just wait in the front to read something after the song is finished.
If only I could see me as you see me, and understand the way that I am loved. Would it give a whole new meaning to my purpose? Change the way I see the world? Would I sparkle like a star in the night sky? Would I give a little more instead of take? If I understood I'm precious like a diamond, we both know it would change up.
day. I would love even if it cost me. Take a chance and know I'm gonna be okay. I would dare to give my life away. I feel lonely, stay up with me. We both know it would change everything. If only I believe. If only I believe the truth about me.
Okay, if you would go ahead and just read, we'll just go with the first section. These are bookmarks for the freedom in Christ, saying who we are in Christ. And we're just going to go down the line in the order that you are. We'll just do the first section because of time. So if you'll just read one.
John chapter 1, verse 12, I am God's child.
John 15, 15, I am Christ's friend.
Romans 5, 1, I have been justified.
1 Corinthians 6:17, I am united with the Lord, one spirit.
1 Corinthians 6:19 and 20, I am bought with a price, I belong to God.
1 Corinthians 12:27, I am a member of Christ's body.
Ephesians 1:1, I am a saint.
Ephesians 1:5, I have been adopted as God's child.
Ephesians 2:18, I have access to God through the Holy Spirit.
Colossians 1:14, I have been redeemed and forgiven.
Colossians 2:10, I am complete in Christ.
I'm going to read a song by Jason Gray called Remind Me Who I Am. It says, when I lose my way and I forget my name, remind me who I am. In the mirror, all I see is who I don't want to be. Remind me who I am. In the loneliest places, when I can't remember what grace is, remind me who I am. Tell me once again who I am to you. Who I am to you. Tell me, lest I forget, who I am to you, that I belong to you. When my heart is like a stone and I'm running far from home, remind me who I am. When I can't perceive your love, afraid I'll never be enough, remind me who I am. If I'm your beloved, can you help me believe it? Tell me once again who I am to you. Tell me, lest I forget who I am to you, that I belong to you. I'm the one you love, that will be enough. I'm the one you love. As you heard in different circumstances in this song, Jason is asking God for a reminder of who he is and that he's God's beloved. As I mentioned earlier, we need each other. And I wanted everybody standing up here, another sense of humor, everybody standing up here to be a picture story of how much we need each other. Everybody has a different voice. And I want to challenge you to be that arm holder when someone has lost their way or forgotten how God sees them, but not how we think they should be. The music team is going to come up and close.
As they're coming up, I just want to share something. I was reminded as she was speaking of the fact that Jesus told a story about he prepared a banquet and he invited a bunch of people and they all had excuses for why they couldn't be there. In this room right now, there's three groups of people. Lazarus was dying, and his sister sent for Jesus, said, "Please come. Please help my brother. He's very sick." And Jesus didn't come right away, but when he got there, Lazarus was already dead. So Jesus did what he could do, what only he could do, and he raised him from the dead. But then he said to the people around, Lazarus came out bound up in all his grave clothes, just wrapped all up. And Jesus said to the people, "You loose him. You let him go." And there's three groups of people in the room right now. Some, maybe. There may be somebody here that's dead. You've never been saved. You haven't given your life to the Lord. You don't know what that's all about. You could be in that category. The second category is, you could need help yourself. You could be the one that's bound up in those grave clothes and saying to yourself, "Will I ever be free? Will I ever be free?" The answer is yes, if you want to be free. And the third thing is, you could be here, you're already saved, you're already free yourself, but you know people who aren't. And you're saying to yourself, "What can I do?" God is inviting all of us to a training session that will enable us to help the people that are hurting. And I think, how many sessions are there? 10 sessions. I think that everybody in this church should make as supreme an effort as we can to clear our Tuesday night schedules for the next 10 weeks and take advantage of this opportunity, because we live in a needy community. We're needy ourselves. There's all of us that have some kind of a hang-up that we need to be free of. God wants to free us of it. But he also wants to use us to let other people free. So consider that as we sing this song. Go ahead, Ben.
Dead will rise through you, our hearts will.
You can just remain standing. I just wanted to let you know that Terry and Cindy Lou will be back at a book table in the back. Cindy Lou will be starting this class, Victory Over the Darkness, a study on Tuesday, October 8th. As she said, 10 weeks, please avail yourself of that. Our ushers will have buckets in the back. We told you last week that we were going to be receiving a benevolence offering, and so today you could be free to give as well. How's that? I want to tell you that when I was a young man, I believed that I was going to die by the time I was 35. And I lived my life that way until God set me free. God sets us free. We can run. We can have peace. We can have joy. The worship team's going to sing this again, and you're free to be dismissed. But God wants to set us free. Amen? Amen. Stop at the table. Say hi to Terry and to Cindy Lou and thank them. Maybe there's a book you'd like to pick up. And please feel free to give. Take it away.
Thanks for joining us for today's broadcast. You're also invited to join us in person, Sunday mornings at 10:30 a.m.
Viewers like you help to make this program possible. If you'd like to help, send your tax-deductible contributions to the address on your screen or give online at cfcdl.org. Thank you.
Enjoy this program, we'd love to hear from you. Comments can be sent to us online or write to us at the address on your screen. Thanks again for joining us. See you next week.